I've acquired my first app. It's only 4 months old, does about $800 in monthly recurring revenue, gets about 3,000 to 4,000 downloads per month, has a high number of ratings for only being 4 months old, and ranks pretty well in ASO. But it's not the type of app I expected to buy and add to my portfolio. So in this video, we'll talk about why I chose this app, how much I paid for it, kinda, how the acquisition process went, what my goals and expectations are for this acquisition, how I plan to grow it, and what I learned for future acquisitions. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. So I acquired an AI Roche generator app. It's an AI wrapper where you upload an image of yourself or a friend, select how intense you want the roast to be, send it off to an AI model, and it returns a handful of jokes about the image. It's a fun little app. Give it a download, check it out, maybe leave a 5-star review. The link is in the description. And I mean, it's not a crazy complex app. There's tons of these apps on the App Store. And like I said, it's not something I'm really interested in or excited to work on. I've said I want my portfolio to be just a handful of apps, like 5 or 6 apps that I'm super interested in the problem they're solving and I can work on long term. That was my goal. For quick context, I put out this tweet in this video a couple months ago saying that I had a 100K budget to acquire 2 or 3 apps. Nothing came of it a couple months ago, had a few different talks, but nothing ever materialized. And then I retweeted this tweet just a couple weeks ago, and then the seller of this app contacted me via email. So that's how I found this app. That's how we got here. So like I said, this app isn't something I thought I would go for. So why did I spend the money to acquire it? Well, when I initially got the email, I dismissed it right away. Like I was like, I don't want an AI roast app. That's silly. I don't want that. But one metric in the email caught my eye. It had like 380 something ratings with a 4.8 average. And I had seen these AI wrapper type apps before. A lot of times they get roasted in the reviews for being scammy or too expensive, all this stuff. So this app, for only being 4 months old, had almost 400 ratings and a 4.8 average. So I was like, okay, that piqued my interest a little bit. Enough to ask for more metrics from the seller. So then I saw, okay, 4,000 downloads per month. I can work with that. So the interest level is like slowly creeping up. And I checked, there wasn't a crazy spike in downloads. So it didn't go viral on TikTok one day and, you know, it's unsustainable. Pretty steady. Then I checked out its ASO and where it ranks for some decently popular keywords. That was pretty good. So I was like, all right, these downloads, this revenue, it seems legit. Then I actually downloaded the app and played with it. And it was actually decently designed. It wasn't just slop thrown together real quickly. You can tell it wasn't vibe coded. So it was like every little step I took, the interest level slowly went up a little bit. Like I said, I started at an immediate dismissal. Then I was like, oh, the ratings are interesting. Let me ask for a little more. Oh, that's interesting. So my interest level went from no way in hell to, let me at least take a look, to maybe. And then finally I got to the point after seeing all this where I was like, okay, it's not what I'm interested in, but if it's a great deal, I'll do it. So that's what I did. I made my offer, which was decently lower than the asking price, and I was honest with the seller. I said, this is not the type of app I'm looking for. I'm actually not that interested in working on it, but you have really good numbers and that piqued my interest. So if the price is right, I'm willing to buy. Like I was open and upfront. Now, on the surface, that can also sound like a negotiation tactic, but it was the genuine truth. Like I said, I'm not interested in an AI roast app. And even though my offer was decently lower than the asking price, we were able to make it work for a couple reasons. The seller had this listed on Acquire, which I didn't even know about. Again, the seller responded to my tweet via email. So by not doing the deal through Acquire, that saved the seller, who was working with another buyer via Acquire, a considerable amount of seller fees. So that made coming down on the asking price a little more manageable. And then I was also ready to buy like right away and could pay cash. So with that, the seller accepted the offer and we began the transfer process. Now, aside from the impressive metrics and the good price, there was two other major reasons why I acquired this app. The first is that I wanted experience with an AI wrapper app. Now, of course, I use AI every day, ChatGPT Pro, Codex, all that stuff. However, I've never built anything with it. Now, it's not like I built this app, but now that I own the app, I am building in it. It's using my OpenAPI developer key I'm working with and seeing the OpenAI backend. So getting experience building something with AI as a developer, not just a user of AI, was another big reason. And then the last reason was just getting experience going through the process of an acquisition. And this was a relatively small deal. So this was perfect to kind of get my feet wet, go through the process for the first time, see where the gotchas are and where the potential headaches are, get that out of the way on a small deal. So when it comes time to do the bigger deals, I'll have done this before, I'll be more comfortable. So yeah, metrics were good, price was right, I got experience with an AI wrapper, and I got experience doing the transfer process. That made this deal a no-brainer for me, even though it's not the type of app I was looking for. Okay, you're probably wondering, how much did I pay for this app? Well, I'm not going to say exactly, but based on my research and the negotiations and conversations I've had looking to acquire other apps, what I've seen is that apps right now are going between 2 and 5 times annual recurring revenue. Now, take that with a grain of salt. I am not an industry expert. That's just what I've been seeing lately talking to people. And obviously that multiple, that 2 to 5 times ARR, that depends drastically on the app, the genre. Is the app growing fast? Is the app plateauing? Is the app declining? Like, there's so many factors that go into what makes up that multiple. But again, that's the range that I've been seeing. And like I said, I got a good price on it, so you don't have to be a rocket scientist to get a ballpark figure on what I paid for it. So how did the transfer process work? Because this is what I didn't know. This is what I wanted to get experience in, and I bet maybe you don't know either. So once we agreed on a price, the first thing I did was have ChatGPT write up a quick 1.5-page contract, outline the details of the deal, what we negotiated, how the deal was going to go, and then we both signed it. Now, quick note on that, I'm not saying that is legally binding. It was more so to get everything in writing very clear so we both understood it, because let's be honest, this was an international deal as well, so who knows how that goes legally, and the price wasn't enough to go to court to fight it, right? The legal fees would make that not worth it. So I am not saying this contract was legally binding. We had a lawyer do it. It was more so just to have it crystal clear in writing what we were going to do for the deal. And again, we were fine with that because it was a relatively small deal. So once that written contract was in place, we both signed it. I sent him a small fraction of the purchase price as a deposit. And then once he received that, just kind of proved the payment mechanics worked internationally, they transferred the app on App Store Connect. They transferred the GitHub repo to my account. They transferred the revenue cap project to my account, the website, the backend, all the other accounts like Firebase and all that stuff was all transferred to me. Once everything was 100% in my possession, we tested everything, it worked. The app was using my OpenAI API key. Then I made the final payment and the transaction was complete, done. And that whole process took about 2 days. Now, of course, my situation is a little unique because I'm known in the iOS dev community. The seller had watched my videos for a long time, you know, knew me a bit. Because I know you're probably thinking, wow, the seller just transferred all the stuff based on a small deposit. How do they know you weren't gonna screw them? And like I said, that there was just trust built up. And I was honest with the seller too. I had this conversation. I was like, hey, this is a relatively small amount of money. The hit to my whatever brand I have, whatever good name I have in the community, whatever you want to say to that, the hit that that would take by screwing someone out of an app is nowhere near worth the amount of money that this was. Because remember, like, I make my living selling courses, videos, and all that stuff. Like, my goodwill with the community and reputation and brand, whatever, that is very valuable to me. That is basically how I make my living. So I wouldn't do anything to tarnish that. So like I said, my situation, having the seller trust me to send all that stuff based on a small deposit, is probably unique to me a little bit. If you were going to acquire an app or sell an app, you would definitely want to use an escrow service. And in fact, the only reason I was cool doing the deal this way was because it was relatively small. On a much bigger deal, even with that trust, goodwill, all that stuff, like, I would still use an escrow service. One thing I will say the seller did a great job at was compartmentalizing all the accounts in the app's name. So for example, the Firebase account, all the backend website accounts, all that stuff was in the Roast app email, right? It wasn't his personal email that he had to like peel off and separate and all that stuff. Everything about the app, it was almost like he knew he was going to sell it, was compartmentalized nice and neat into this one little package. So the vast majority of what he had to do was give me control of that email account, and I basically had everything. So that made it a lot easier. So if you ever think you're going to sell an app and you're building one, I would make sure you compartmentalize all those accounts into its own separate thing. Makes it a lot easier to transfer. Now let's talk about my goals and expectations for this acquisition. Because before you buy something strategically, you have to be like, all right, what value can I add to it? What can I do to grow it? Can I grow it so that this is a profitable transaction? And if the answer is no to any of that, you don't buy it. So obviously I felt the answer was yes. So let's talk about what the expectations are on what I felt made it worth it to do the deal. A big factor on why I did this deal was that I calculated that if I grow the app even just a little bit, I can probably return the initial investment in about a year or so. And then after I return the initial investment, well, now I own the income generating asset free and clear. Like, I've made my money back. I've at least broke even. So it felt like a very low risk acquisition to me. Now, about that growth, like I said, the app is currently doing about 800 monthly recurring revenue. And I've heard of other apps in this space doing 10 times that. Now, I'm not saying I'm going to come in and 10x the monthly recurring revenue, but knowing that, it's like, okay, can I 2x it, 3x it? Like, can I get this to 2000 MRR, 3000 MRR? That seems pretty reasonable because the original seller did zero marketing. It got to 800 MRR, just pure ASO. So there's been no Apple search ads. There's been no TikTok marketing. There's been no anything done. So growing the MRR 2x, 3x by throwing some marketing dollars behind it, I think is pretty reasonable. And that's really all my expectation is for this first acquisition. Just grow it a little bit, return the investment, and I got experience again with the AI wrapper. I got experience going through the transfer process. So even if all I do is break even, like, the app just dies after I break even, and I got all this experience, it was well worth it. So my expectations are pretty low, right? I don't think I'm gonna light the world on fire with this app, but again, it was a great first acquisition to just get experience with the whole process. And then once I get it to break even, well, now I have optionality. I can just let the asset keep generating income each month, or I can try and flip it and sell it back again for a profit and then roll that profit into a bigger acquisition, which we'll talk about later on what I learned from this acquisition on what I would do differently next time. But before we talk about that, let's talk about how I plan to grow it. Now, the obvious thing is TikTok marketing, right? This kind of app really lends itself to that whole TikTok UGC stuff. And again, another reason why I felt like this was a good acquisition for me, I've never done any TikTok marketing. I'll probably suck at it, but this is a great vehicle for me to get in there, do some experience, learn UGC TikTok marketing, because that is a huge way to market apps, obviously now in 2025. So we're gonna try the whole TikTok thing. Might be a colossal failure, but hey, I'm gonna get experience with it. And then of course, we'll throw some Apple Search Ads money behind it just to see if that's a viable path. And then I'm gonna do some localization in a couple different languages, but localization is tricky because roasting someone is like a slang term. And you can't just directly translate roast into all the languages and it makes sense for the app. And the whole app is centered around the word roast. So it's localization is a little tricky, but we're gonna give that a shot. So yeah, I have a couple experiments in mind for marketing along with different monetization strategies. So we'll let those play out, see what works, and then double down on what works. Again, I'm not trying to light the world on fire with this acquisition, but just 2 to 3xing MRR, like that's the goal. So what did going through this process teach me about my next acquisition? Well, first of all, I'm still in the market for apps. I have the vast majority of that 100K budget left. So if you have an app that you're looking to sell that does 1,000 to 2,000 MRR, let me know, hit me up, email or DM me on Twitter. But that's the first thing I learned is that I need to go bigger because at least for me, like having a bunch of apps, like there's just so much work that goes into it, like building the product. You know, we have to update it all for iOS 26, every single app. You have all the ASO, the marketing, the customer service, like each app is a lot of work. So I don't want to get in the position where I have 10, 15 apps all making $1,000 a month. That is way too much work, spread way too thin. Like I said, I want my portfolio to be just a small handful of apps that all grow very well. So my next acquisition will be a lot bigger. That's what I learned. That if I'm going to take on the mental load of owning an app, building it, all the marketing and stuff, I can't be buying these small ones. So that's my main takeaway. Other than that, the transfer process, now that I've done it once, that feels pretty straightforward, not worried about that. So yeah, I'm excited to acquire my next one. So again, if you do fall into that range, that 1000 MRR, 2000 MRR or more, hit me up, let's talk. And if you're a developer watching this video and you have some apps that you think you might want to sell one day, it's a great idea to have all those apps on a website, a portfolio that showcases this work, lets people easily find out about your apps. And each one of those apps needs a website in and of itself. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and the analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain.